If you're new to our Pearson Work Holding Fixer Friday series, this is the perfect episode to watch because I'm gonna highlight the best parts of the previous 19 episodes and give some bonus work holding tips that I didn't mention the first time around. Let's get started. Okay, a quick overview. We have three main product lines that we feature. Our pallet systems allow you to harness the power of high density work holding and about 20 second pallet changes so you can plow through production. Our vacuum systems use the seemingly magical approach to hold flat work pieces with extremely high vacuum levels. And finally, our Rotovice Pro takes high density work holding to the next level by harnessing the often unused Z volume of your machine's travel and allows you access to multiple faces of your part, which greatly reduces setups. Now, they all have unique approaches to maximize efficiency and profits. We'll add a link in the video description below for each one of them. Fixture Friday 1 is important because it establishes the approach to high density work holding using our products. Now in episode 1, we went from 2 parts in a vise to 24 on one pallet. Now keep in mind that you always want to have 2 identical pallets so that when one is in the machine, the other pallet is outside where parts are changed. This radically reduces idle spindle time and is a massive production boost on its own. Fixture Friday number 2 showed how pallets hold up over time when running steel parts in high quantities. 2 big takeaways here. First, yes, you can hold steel parts in an aluminum fixture. I get a lot of customers asking if we can make pallets out of steel to make them more durable. Well, in theory, yes, but in reality, you do not want to be lifting a 40 to 70 pound steel pallet in and out of the machine. Just go with aluminum and follow my tips in this video to design for durability. Now, a quick side note. I've lost a sale or 2 because a customer insisted that we must make steel pallets so that they wouldn't wear out. But the approach I use in general is I don't solve a problem before it's actually a problem. Now, will the clamping features of an aluminum pallet wear out quicker? Yeah, but to date, we made about 22,000 parts with over 2,700 pallet changes using the fixture before finally retiring it. So Fixture Friday number 3 is packed with lots of great info, and honestly, I'd recommend just watching that one on its own. But if there's one thing that I would highlight, it's my opening comments. Don't pressure yourself to make a multi-operation pallet. Just keep it simple and tackle the first operation alone. Typically, the first op has the majority of the machining, so by palletizing this op, you'll still be way ahead of the game in terms of efficiency. Okay, Fixture Friday 4. It's not that exciting. I talk about origins and where to place them, but I don't want you to miss the main point: standardized origins. Now, using a standard origin means you only probe a surface one time ever, and you use this permanent standardized origin for all of your fixtures. Again, it's boring stuff, but man, standardized origins is a big deal. It's under 3 minutes, so definitely check it out. Now, in contrast to Fixture Friday number 3, Fixture Friday number 5 showed the second operation of a part where we palletized 48 parts per cycle on a single pallet. Can someone give me a ka-ching? I mean, compared to a traditional approach of holding a few parts in a vise, yeah, it's not even a fair fight. Fixture Friday number 6 was our first smart vac episode where we leveraged the use of 400 grit sandpaper sandwiched between our part and the chuck. Now, this technique increases the traction between the two elements to the point where we quadrupled our feed rates. Remember, the holding power of vacuum is determined by the surface area exposed to the vacuum on the plane of the gasket. Now, the smaller the part, the lower the holding force. Now, it's not likely you're going to lift a part off a vacuum chuck. What actually happens is the side forces from the cutter can shift the part sideways, and that is a typical point of failure. Now, sandpaper helps keep the part in place. How about a bonus tip? Don't use anything other than Gorilla Glue, because Gorilla Glue is water activated and typically impervious to coolant. Now, I'd also recommend scuffing the surface of your top plate to give the glue a good surface to adhere to. Fixture Friday 8 and number 15 go hand in hand. In these episodes, we hold parts from the bottom using fasteners in what I call the knife maker's method. Now, we're a production shop that embraces lean manufacturing. So in these two videos, you'll see the results of continual improvement by increasing the number of parts per cycle, as well as making the pallet a lot more user-friendly. Speaking of continual improvement, Fixture Friday number 10 shows our improvements to the pallet seen in Fixture Friday number 2. And in that episode, I demonstrate some advanced design approaches by using the same pocket for two clamps. We also increase the part density from 16 parts on the old pallet to 24 parts while maintaining a very similar pallet weight. Fixture Friday 11 is another SmartVac video where we use a customizable top plate to both hold the workpiece and the remnant material. It's also a great video to watch as a practical overview on how to harness the power of vacuum for your production parts. So Fixture Friday number 12 is a goldmine of bite-sized information on fixture building and is one of my most shared Fixture Fridays to date. Now, the approach I took is to highlight what not to do when designing a fixture. I'll leave it at that, so make sure and watch Fixture Friday 12, link in the description below. Fixture Friday number 14. Okay, so this was the first episode in which we featured our pallets for the RotoVice Pro, and not to spoil it, but I got a little excited. I'm just excited for our own production, you know? Anyway, by applying high density work holding to our RotoVice Pro, we absolutely crush it when it comes to multi-part, multi-face machining. It's another must-watch video, and I'll put a link in the description below, but check out this footage. Fixture Friday 16, hold parts with no clamps. Sounds like clickbait, but it's not. Now, because we design our own products, we're able to design in certain features that aid in manufacturing. And in this Fixture Friday, we run the second operation on some five-axis parts. And yes, we don't use any clamps. What we did was we turned some custom screws that have a non-standard 7/8 20 thread to use the bolt through approach, again known as the knife maker's method, to bolt through the bottom of the pallet and into the part. Now, we added a couple bores for pins that locate the part and add lateral stability. Now, what I didn't show the first time around is that we also added snap rings to hold those custom screws in place. In Fixture Friday number 17, we machined some cast iron. And if you've never machined cast iron, it's kind of like machining dirt clods. Sometimes you get chips, sometimes you get dirt. Check out this awesome slow-mo footage. Okay, so beauty shots aside, the big takeaway in this video is the channels under the part so that coolant and chips don't accumulate in the two bores. Now, remachining chips is a major cause of chipped teeth, and getting them out of a blind pocket is always tricky. channels under the part help take care of this. So we covered another cool vacuum application in Fixture Friday 18. Main takeaway, small parts, again, are held with lower holding force due to the lack of surface area. So we always want to nest small parts together out of one larger workpiece. This way, you borrow the surface area from neighboring parts to get higher overall holding force. Now, the trick is to separate them in the second operation using one of our customizable top plates that uses pins to locate each part individually once they're separated from each other. And last but not least, Fixture Friday 19 is another vacuum application. Actually, it's a rule-breaking application. Now, the rule of thumb is if you can hold a part in a vise, go for it. Vacuum is best for large workpieces with plenty of surface area, but in this episode, holding on to material in a vise wouldn't allow us to take a full perimeter cut. So again, vacuum rescued us with the use of a custom top plate to locate the part on using pins. By the way, the product we're making is our smart plate, which allows you to mount a rotary unit outside of your machining envelope so it's not taking up any valuable table space. I'll add a link to the product in the description as well. Well, the next three Fixture Fridays are right around the corner, so consider subscribing so you don't miss them. And as usual, go innovate your production.